For hundreds of years, the Potawatomi who once thrived here celebrated her clean and bountiful waters as a source of life, food, and beauty. They called it Numasopi. The French settlers who lived and traded along her banks for centuries gave her the name Rivière Raisin. The battle cry, "Remember the Raisin," echoed from her banks in 1813, inspiring victory in the War of 1812, a site that today is the River Raisin National Battlefield Park. Steeped in history and with Michigan's only port on Lake Erie, the River Raisin has supported industry, commerce, and a way of life for centuries. Yet with the passing of time, dilution became the solution to pollution, and this once vital waterway fell victim to neglect, contamination, and human-made demise.
Back before 80 years, 100 years ago, all of the waste from the entire community went to the River Raisin. There were no dams. It just went here, and in the summertime, in August, the stream goes extremely low. So you had streams coming out from the community that would come out, and there would be these little cesspools. In the newspaper, it had big articles. Well, it's summer, the river stinks again. So what they decided to do was, let's put a new wastewater treatment plant in. Well, because of the rock table that we've got, you can't just run all the sewage from the north side. You can't dig a trench and have it go to the south side and down to the plant. So they put tiles on the riverbed and they built dams above the tiles. That allowed all of the wastewater to flow on over to this side into a big interceptor and go down and get treated at the wastewater plant. However, what that also did is it held all the water back and made it stagnant. It wasn't free flowing like we see here. We did something to improve on one portion of the environment, but we hurt another area of the environment.
And that's why we raised a generation of children with their parents, mothers and fathers, telling them, don't go there, don't go near the water. This story repeats itself in many, many places. That's why Great Lakes Restoration Initiative, a program of that magnitude, is so critical, because this is not the only place where that happened.
The Raisin was in peril. Years of negligence had burgeoned its sediment to the brink of uninhabitability. Fish and wildlife were simply dying, and by the late 1980s, the River Raisin was listed as a national area of concern by the United States EPA.
So an area of concern was initially designated back in 1987. On the U.S. side of the border, originally there were 31 areas of concern. Since then, four have been delisted, so we now have 27 areas of concern.
And the River Raisin being one. And each one of these areas of concern had beneficial uses that were impaired. They were contaminated with PCBs, polychlorinated biphenyls, or DINAPL, dense non-aqueous phase liquid. The stuff likes to sink down, and it has an affinity for clay, and it hangs onto the clay. So the only way you can get rid of it is to dig out the clay.
PCBs were found in the lower 3-4 miles of the river, impacting wildlife, fish, and potentially impacting humans as well, who eat the fish.
What we did over 100 years and where chemicals and pollution went, it still resides in our sediment. It doesn't clear out of the system quickly or easily on its own.
We have storms that will come up, will churn up the bottom sediments, and the contamination can potentially move into the lake. And where you can make an impact in cleaning up the contamination is in the rivers. Once it gets into the lake, it pretty much disperses, and it's very hard to get a handle on from a remediation or a cleanup standpoint.
And that's why we're working on this restoration of the River Raisin. It's a part of a larger whole, part of an international wildlife refuge.
So the two big issues in this community were reconnecting the river, allowing that flow, the rock ramps, habitat improvements, and the other was removing chemicals, toxics.
Cleaning up the contaminated sediments. I think we all knew we had to remove the PCBs. We had to do a major cleanup.
We had to remove those beneficial use impairments out of the 14 that they established through the International Joint Commission. We had 9 that were bad here. Now we're down to 5 of them to get rid of by monitoring. We've done all of the management actions already. There's a thing they call a CAMU, C-A-M-U. It's a corrective action management unit. We couldn't take all of the dredgings that we took out of the river anyplace else. Nobody wanted them. So we had to take care of it ourselves here. We had to dig down, put in a bentonite liner, which is heavy clay, and then put this material into something like cement and put those blocks in there and cover them over. And they make sure that there's no leachate coming out of those corrective action management units. And that was all done by the Environmental Protection Agency, Region 5.
What else can we do? How else can we help restore some of the degraded habitat?
We've been able to eliminate a number of dams here, either through structural work or totally removing them. We've been able to open up the river all the way to Dundee.
Once we opened it up and took out the dams that we could and made fishways around the dams that we can't, then the fish were able to come back and the birds came back. It's not unusual to see eagles flying up and down right through here, and we've had peregrine falcon and just all types of ducks and geese just all over.
When I was a kid, I didn't see eagles, I didn't see lotus. They were always there, but because of the bad water quality and other things, they just didn't generate, didn't propagate. They've come back tremendously. Suddenly we see the eagles coming back. And you've seen them up here at the battlefield.
The eagles being back is symbolic. It's a sign of the hard work that we've done over 30 to 50 years to reconnect ourselves and understand that what we did had serious consequences. But it also reminds us that we can undo that.
Like never before in our lifetime, the fish, wildlife, and the people who live here are once again thriving in the River Raisin.
What it's telling you is we're getting closer and closer to having a healthy river, one where people feel very comfortable eating the fish that come out of the river. People will feel comfortable wading in that river, kayaking in that river, living next to the river, and they're seeing it as a resource.
As this river heals, as we remove the toxics, as we allow invertebrates to come into this system. So it's not just about the fish, it's also about what fish eat. Invertebrates don't live well in the sediments where there's contamination. Fish don't live well where there's nothing to eat.
We see the fish populations coming back. I mean, there's fish now, they're catching pike all the way up near the Dundee Dam, right? And people are like, yeah, we haven't done that in forever. So we are on a trajectory to get there.
Delisting is only a waypoint. Delisting is not an endpoint. The river will always take care. The river will always take stewardship. People that care for the river will tend the river. People that tend the river will make sure it doesn't get back to where it was before.
With a shared passion for revitalizing this life-giving resource, relentless citizens of Monroe, Michigan worked hand in hand with the US EPA, Great Lakes Restoration Initiative, Michigan Office of the Great Lakes, Michigan DNR, Michigan Department of Environmental Quality, and other partners. Together with their leadership and resources, our river is once again thriving.
The community in Monroe, the Public Advisory Committee in Monroe, was hugely impactful in how we moved ahead with the cleanup here in the River Raisin. These are multi-million dollar projects, and we have to have the support of the community, and the River Raisin community did that, and that's really a testament to the people here.
And I was just in awe and amazed and inspired by what a small group of local citizens with a passion for the river and for the lake, what they could do together to advance restoration activities. And it's just a very inspiring story and a very unique situation that can be modeled in other places around the Great Lakes.
There are other communities that would give their eye teeth to have a river just like the River Raisin running through the middle of their community. One thing I'd like to see is us turn some of our parks around so that we have better access to the river. Just like some of the streetscape and the riverscape projects that we've done here, got a great start going. We can't let it stop there.
You can't put a price tag on being able to use a resource like we have here. And sometimes when people say, hey, this costs too much money, they forget what things were like in the 60s and 70s when rivers were catching on fire, right? So, it has been decades to make the progress that we've made, but it's wonderful to see the progress that has been made on this river.
And now we're beginning to look at the river as something that we can market. Before, it was hard to market it because nobody could go there fishing, you couldn't eat the fish, and you couldn't swim in it, you couldn't do anything, but now it's cleaner. In our last river cleanup, we had a record number of people show up to help us clean the river up, and I thought that was so remarkable. It was fabulous.
The citizens of this community are the stewards of the river, and it's very important to get our young generation out and engaged so that they're connecting with it, and then when these issues come up, they're able to have a good perspective on what things should be. It's not just about us, it's not just about this community, it's about our connectedness to the larger Great Lakes region and our responsibility for the largest freshwater resource in the world.
Getting back to, you know, the whole spiritual aspect of what the Great Lakes can be and the people using that resource and the future generations being able to use that resource, I mean, it feeds my soul. There's no other way to put that.
The perseverance of these partners in restoration has given new meaning to the battle cry, "Remember the Raisin."